Mr. President, I want to talk about the economy today, something that most of us are talking about when we're home, and for good reason. Yesterday, the Labor Department announced that our economy hit a milestone that we'd never hit before in the time that we've been measuring these two things. At the same time, there are now more jobs available in the United States than there are job seekers. When I was in Missouri last week, we did a number of events all over the state, and at that time, I was confident that in the 12 states in the middle of the country, there were more people, there were more jobs than there were people looking for jobs, and that was news. But even bigger news is the news that was announced yesterday that there are 6.7 million job openings, and there aren't 6.7 million people on unemployment. In fact, the unemployment rate is 3.8%. It's the lowest, it matches the lowest number that we've seen in 50 years. And the last time numbers were this low, in fact, was in the Vietnam War, where many young men were being drafted into the military. That was the last time that we had an unemployment rate this low. Now, everybody understands and should understand that the 6.7 million jobs don't necessarily have 6.7 million people ready for exactly the jobs that are out there, which should encourage us, among other things, to be thinking about what do we need to do to be sure that people are either prepared for jobs or they have the skills that allow them to quickly become prepared for the jobs that are available. Two-thirds of Americans say it's a good time to find a job. That's 25% more than in the last administration, think it's a good time to find work. Working with the president, the Senate has done what we could to fuel the economy along with the House, but the House and Senate both have rolled back regulations that didn't meet the common sense test and passed the Tax Cuts and Jobs Act. Remember, Mr. President, the President of the United States kept telling us, don't call this tax reform. Who knows what that means or where it might wind up? What we want to do here is cut people's taxes, increase their take-home pay, and do things that increase jobs. In the 10 cities I was in last week, I think I saw virtually every reporter in the state in that would at least every reporting agency had somebody at those events. We had roundtables with employers. We had meetings with people who were able to buy a house that they couldn't buy otherwise. We had people who really appreciated the extra $500 a year or the extra $152 a month or the extra $200 a month that they were seeing in their family budget that last year would have been sent to Washington, D.C. You know, I said many times during that tax cut debate that there are two ways to increase people's pay. One is to take less money out of it. And I said, and you said, Mr. President, that 9 out of 10 people who paid taxes last year, if we passed that bill, would be paying fewer taxes this year. But the second way to increase people's take-home pay is to give them a better job to start with. And that's what happens in a growing economy. One of the things that I thought was most surprising was how many employers stepped up in how many different ways to say, we appreciate in this economy and want to reward our workforce like we frankly didn't know that we could afford to do and knew we didn't have to do in a more stagnant economy in the past. The companies that gave bonuses, the companies that gave other benefits, the several companies that increased their minimum level of pay, whatever that was. One major national retailer said they were going to increase their minimum wage to $11, and over the next specific number of months, they were going to increase that $11 minimum to a $14 minimum, not because the government told them they had to do that, but because they wanted to be sure in a growing economy, they kept their employees. According to a recent National Federation of Independent Business survey, 76% of small business owners believe the current business climate is headed in the right direction. The National Association of Manufacturers, 86% of those manufacturers plan to increase investments thanks to tax reform, and 77% say they're planning to increase hiring. 72% said they plan to increase wages for their employees. That's the kind of thing that happens in a growing economy. I was at Gray Manufacturing in St. Joseph, Missouri last week, and the president of that company, Stetz Schatz, said his company is among those feeling optimistic about the future. They're trying right now to find the 20 workers they need to fill the 20 jobs they had. In my hometown of Springfield, Mary Beth Hartman, the president of a local construction company, said she'd been able not only to hand out employee bonuses, but to buy the new equipment, the new trucks that they'd been waiting for some time to buy until they were sure they'd move from a time when you have to take what money you have and repair something to where you really can make the kind of long-term investment that, frankly, the tax bill encourages you to do. And also, if you're a business and you're even doing as well as you did last year, you just have more money than you have last year. You take some of that money off the table by buying the equipment and replacing the equipment that you've been hoping to do for a long time. Jamie Berger in Boot Hill, Scott County presiding commissioner, told me everywhere we go, hiring signs are up. That's true in our state. I think it's true all over the country. At least 1 million new jobs have been created since the tax code changes passed. And it wasn't, again, I'll be reminded by the president if I don't say it, it wasn't, again, the tax code changes. It was the Tax Cuts and Job Act that the Congress and the president worked together to create. I met local officials and business owners who were located, who had opportunity zones. This is a idea that's in the tax bill. Senator Scott and others were really thinking about what can we do to encourage people to put money in those communities that aren't doing as well as others around them, and so take economically stressed census areas and allow a new kind of investment to occur in those census areas where you take your capital gains profits that you very likely made somewhere else, and you put them in real estate or in a business or in some other way you invest them in one of the opportunity zones. We have 161 in our state. When I was with the mayor of Hannibal and Mayor Harms and local officials in Hannibal, they were certainly talking about what to do there. In Kansas City, well, I was with the electric company, Kansas City Power and Light. They actually have based a new local access point in one of those opportunity zones near the historic 18th and Vine area, the jazz area in Kansas City. But what they really were talking about in that particular opportunity to talk about what the tax code changes have done, what the tax cuts bill has done, they're in the process of reducing electric bills for their customers by $100 million because that's how many fewer taxes they're going to send, tax dollars they're going to send to Washington than they did last year. And by the way, every one of those tax dollars gets passed along to a ratepayer, just like every one of those tax savings also gets passed along to a ratepayer. The economy is moving again. The tsunami of red tape that we saw in the last few years piling well over $100 billion of extra cost onto the government. I've seen by their own estimates that number was up to $700 billion when you project that number into the 10-year future. $700 billion of extra red tape. The president took office, was able to eliminate some things that hadn't gotten done yet. And the Congress was able to overturn 16 rules that had significant compliance cost savings under the Congressional Review Act, which had been used exactly one time in the history of the law until this Congress and this president were able to do it to reverse rules that were slowing the economy down. The clean power rule that would have doubled utility bills in Missouri in a decade or so, the Waters of the U.S. rule that would have put the EPA in charge of things that they shouldn't be in charge of. And by the way, neither of those rules had been allowed to go into effect, not because of the calendar, but because of the courts. In both cases, courts had turned to the past administration and said, you can't do that. And in that, instead of continuing to appeal the you can't do that decision by courts, Trump administration reversed those policies. And we still have lots of protections, but we don't have protections beyond what the government is legally allowed to do. And by the way, those protections were just so-called protections. It definitely would have slowed the economy down, whether they would have definitely added much to either our water or our power policies is a big debate. Keeping regulations where they needed to be, working to confirm well-qualified nominees to both the courts and the administration, really important. You know, we're going to be here in August this year. I wouldn't want to fall into the trap of suggesting that Congress isn't taking a vacation in August. What Congress isn't doing in August, at least the Senate's not able to do, is to be home doing the work we need to do at home. Part of the job of a member of the House or a member of the Senate is to be talking to people where they work, talking to the people they work for, seeing those problems firsthand, being part of that discussion going on where you live. But we're not doing that this August. The leaders, our leader said we're going to be here. Part of it is that the other side has just taken so much time to make it so difficult for the president to get his team in place. Never had anything like this happen before in the history of the country, or for judges to be confirmed, for U.S. attorneys to be confirmed. Senate Democrats have forced 100 cloture votes. Now, what's a cloture vote? A cloture vote really is a demand that you have hours of debate, up to 30 hours of debate, before someone is confirmed. Yesterday, we had a long time set aside for debate, insisted on. There was, shockingly, not so shockingly, no debate, but the vote was almost unanimous. After hours of not being able to do anything but have the floor open for debate for someone that there was no debate about. That's happened 100 times in this Congress and this presidency. In the last 15 months, that's happened 100 times. In the previous six administrations, in the first full 2 years of all six of them combined, that happened 24 times. So we've gone from an average of the last six presidencies of 4 times a presidency to 100 times for this presidency, and that is not acceptable. The long-term solution to that, by the way, is not to be here in August. The long-term solution is to change that rule. That rule's being abused. It needs to be changed. The committee I chair has voted that rules change out of the committee. And when my colleagues get tired of the rules being abused, that's when we'll be able to change the rules. At the same time, we've confirmed a lot of judges. And matter of fact, 18%, one out of eight of all federal court of appeals judges have been nominated by President Trump and confirmed by the Senate. And our friends on the other side say, well, gee, how can you be bragging about the president being able to get all these judges confirmed and complaining about how much time it took? They know, and I know, and people watching the Senate know, that we managed to get those judges confirmed, but the loss, and it was a devastating loss, was the ability to get on with other legislative work. We should be debating the appropriations bills one bill at a time. We ought to have an infrastructure bill on the floor. We should today be debating the Defense Authorization Act. We have a lot of work to do, and our friends on the other side of the aisle know that every hour they force to be taken for something else, and certainly a lifetime judicial appointment is important, But every hour they force to be needlessly taken for that is an hour that the Senate can't get to anything else. So we're going to put a lot of those hours back on the table in April. And we're going to continue to do that work and hopefully do the work of publicly and visibly and in a way where every member is allowed to offer every amendment they want to debate how we spend people's money, to debate how we defend the country, to debate how we try to do things that encourage us to be more competitive. We have a full agenda ahead of us. We're going to be here for the rest of the year working on that agenda. I look forward to that. Hopefully the economic news will continue. Even the New York Times, no particular group of that has run out of words to praise the administration with or the Congress with, said last week they had run out of words to talk about how good the job numbers were. When the New York Times runs out of words to talk about how good the economy is, the economy must be really good. It can be better. It needs to be better. We need to continue to see people, not just with more take-home pay, but now our goal should be more take-home pay because they have better jobs, and people have better jobs in a stronger economy. We are headed in that direction. Let's be sure we continue to head there.